Good afternoon, everyone. If you don't mind, let's stand and sing our first song. Good to see everyone.
Shall not fail through all eternity. Amen. And it's not going to fail in heaven. It shouldn't fail here. We ought to be praising the Lord and giving him glory in all things. What a blessing to come in this house tonight to worship the Lord. If you don't know him, you can before you leave. You need a church home, the doors are welcome to receive you. And we just praise God that you can be a part of praise and honor and glory to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords tonight. So let's go to God in prayer. Father, how we thank you for this day. We thank you for this week. We thank you for the reminder of all things that are going on as we look at you in the last week here on planet Earth. That, Lord, you came to die for us. But you didn't just come to die for us. You came to live for us. And because you died on that old rugged cross and brought us salvation through your precious blood, you also arose and lived that we might live also. Yes. And what a joy to know that one of these days we shall look upon you in praise and adoration, which we ought to be practicing right now. Amen. And God, we just pray that you'll be with us in this service tonight for every decision that needs to be made. In Christ's name, amen. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. Again, we want to thank those who were involved in the father-daughter banquet and the things that they did to make it great. And those who were here enjoyed it and had a great time of fellowship and the blessing of it all. We're so thankful for that. Remember, the Hannah group is going to meet Monday night at 6:30. All of you ladies are asked to bring salads and sandwiches. I hope all of you ladies will come and attend in this Holy Week as we think about what the Lord has done, what the Lord is going to do in his last days here on earth. Remember, of course, Friday, Good Friday. It's called good because of what Jesus did on the cross, because we look beyond the cross and we see the resurrection of his everlasting power. On Sunday morning at 7 o'clock, we'll have sunrise service followed by breakfast. And we hope that you will be here and bring someone with you. And then our regular schedule, Sunday school at 10, worship at 11. And then Sunday evening, we're going to celebrate the Lord's Supper as we think about the body and the blood of Jesus, who gave it all for us. Also, be much in prayer down the road for several other things that are taking place. Remember our men's ministry fellowship on the 13th, and our guest speaker will be Brother Robbie Harrington from over at Lake Park. And I know all of our men and boys here, invite them, encourage them to be here. And you make sure that you've got that time circled to be here yourself at 5 o'clock on April the 13th. I think it's going to begin with a fish fry, time of fellowship, and great speaker, so you look forward to that. And then revival, April 21st through 24th. Brother Brian Harrington will be here, and I hope that you'll be praying and seeking the face of God, and all the information is in the bulletin. It's also the time of our giving and praying for home missions, and I think we have a video with that. I think we had a bug up here about to invade the premises. Y'all pray over him. He is no more.
Thank you, Brother Ben. As mentioned this morning, we're going to see a video, and it's how our gifts funds the North American Mission Board.
When you and your church give, you send hope. In small towns, big cities, college campuses, God uses your sacrificial giving and your partnership with the North American Mission Board to make this happen over and over again. And at NAM, we think it's important for you to know how God uses your gifts to produce results. Southern Baptist churches like yours fund North American missions through two primary sources. First, the cooperative program. Your gifts to the CP typically come from your church budget and then go directly to your state convention. Each state then sends a portion of that money to the SBC Executive Committee, and from there, more than half of CP goes to the International Mission Board. NAM, SBC seminaries, and other entities receive a percentage as well. NAM receives 22.79% of cooperative program dollars. We use those funds to support evangelism events, to support ministry centers and missionaries, to endorse chaplains, and for operations. Altogether, those funds make up 35% of our budget. But the largest part of NAM's budget, 50%, comes from the Annie Armstrong Easter offering for North American missions. More than 100 years ago, this offering was named for a bold missions advocate who rallied SBC churches in support of missionaries. Today, Southern Baptists have thousands of missionaries serving in North America. They are spreading the gospel through Send Network, our church planning arm, and Send Relief, our evangelistic compassion ministry area. And when you give to the Annie Armstrong Easter offering through special offerings, your church budget, or directly to NAM, you're helping these missionaries by providing the fuel to assess, train, coach, and care for them. It helps pay for things like Bibles, curriculum, ministry equipment, or even rent for a worship facility. Some churches may refer to this offering as the North America Missions offering or something else. Whatever you choose to call the Annie Armstrong Easter offering, it is unique because every dollar goes directly to support missionaries where the need and the opportunity are the greatest. It goes all over North America, including our largest, most influential cities, where the gospel presence has been on the decline. Your giving helps plant new, reproducing churches. And now, in many urban areas, we're starting to gain ground. It goes to places like international and refugee communities where tens of thousands of people, many from countries closed to the gospel, move every year. Your giving is sending missionaries to love them and share the hope of Christ. In 100 different ways, in 1,000 different places, all of your gifts are enabling missionaries to start new churches, baptize new believers, and make disciples. That's how your giving works. As you pray and give, we at the North American Mission Board are so grateful to be your partner, helping you fulfill the Great Commission. Together with you and your church, every day, we are sending hope.
Hoboken Baptist Church family, when we say thank you, it's not just words. It comes from our thankful hearts. So thank you as we continue to pray and give. And we'll be seeing y'all Sunday week after Easter, and we'll probably finalize our emphasis then. But thank you again so much.
Now, y'all, if you don't mind, let's stand and sing. I want to see you.
As I turn it through the land, singing as I go, on his soul to Calvary, to the crimson flow, many arrows pierce my soul from without within, but my Lord leads me on through the mindless wind. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When in service for my Lord, dark may be the night, but I'll cling more close to him, he will give me light. Satan's snares may vex my soul, turn my thoughts aside, but my Lord goes ahead, leads for every time. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When in valleys, oh, I look toward the mountain high, and behold my Savior there, leading in the fight, with a tender hand outstretched toward the valley low. Guiding me, I can see, as I onward go, oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice. When before me billows rise from the mighty deep, then my Lord directs my bark, he is safely keep, and he leads me gently on through the world below. He's a great friend to me, oh, I love him so. Oh, I want to see him, look upon his face, there to sing forever of his saving grace. On the streets of glory, let me lift my voice. Cares all past, home at last, ever to rejoice.
If y'all don't mind, we're going to sing Kneel at the Cross, and this will be for the offertory.
Kneel at the cross, Christ will meet you there. Come while he waits for you. Listen to his voice. Trust on.
like to bring God's tithe and to bring an offering. We also come to pray one for another as we remember in prayer Mike Drew, Lennon and Craig Hodge, also Ann Hickox, Michelle Johns, Diane Johns, Jimmy Lee. We pray for our upcoming revival and pray for Brother Brian Harrington. Also lift to the Lord in prayer those on our friends and neighbors, Donna Chatham, Faye McMillan, Robert Thomas, Bill Faircloth, Theron Gill, Stacy Cruz and Kathy Cruz, Kenny Larrison, Kevin Nickel. Also remember Jay Harper, Tony Griffin, Keith McDowell, Roger Lee. Pray for Keith McCorvey, and also lift up Josh Marshall as we come before the Lord in prayer. Pray especially, we have on our homebound Hubert Strickland. That is Summer Gowan's father. He had another stroke, and she asked this morning that we especially pray for him. And then remember the family of George Wester, the family of Sharon Lee, the family of Larry Rowell, and the family of Layla Jones. That's Brother Richard's mother who passed away. Her service will be at 1 p.m. tomorrow at Edo Miller Funeral Home in Brunswick. And we appreciate Brother Rodney filling in for him tonight. Amen. So we go to the Lord in prayer as one of our men will lead us as we pray.
Lord, I want to thank you for allowing us to be out in your house tonight, Lord. Lord, it means so much to us, Lord, that you went to that cross, Lord, and you shed that blood, Lord. Lord, that without that, Lord, where would we be at today, Lord? Lord, just you covered our sins, Lord, and Lord, we abused you so much, Lord, and Lord, I want to apologize for what I do, Lord. And Lord, just as we take up this money tonight, Lord, we use it to beg in your church in the future, Lord. And Lord, just go with Brother Ben the next little bit, Lord, as he gives us a message you'd have us to hear, Lord. And each and every one on this prayer list, Lord, you know each and every need, Lord. Lord, just be with these folks, Lord, and the ones that lost loved ones, Lord. Just comfort them families, Lord, as only you can, Lord. And Lord, I want to thank you for everything you've done. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. May be seated.
Thank you. just play this, push that. Put it in this right now. Yeah. And go down to the bottom of it.
This isn't fun, but it saves homeowners a fortune.
Close, boy.
Why doesn't every homeowner have brand new windows?
Let's go back to the bottom of that list. Yeah. No. Down.
Right there.
Right there. Kelvis. Kelvis. Karaoke right there. I'm so tired and so weary, but I must go along till the Lord comes and calls me away. Oh, yeah. Well, the moon is so bright and the Lamb is the light, and the night is as black as the sea. Oh, yeah. Oh, there will be peace in the valley for me someday. There will be peace in the valley for me, oh Lord, I pray. There'll be no sadness, no sorrow, no trouble I see. There will be peace in the valley for me. The bear will be gentle, and the wolf will be tame, and the lion shall lay down by the lamb. Oh, yeah. And the beast from the wild shall be led by a child, and I'll be changed from this creature that I am. Oh, yeah. Oh, there will be peace in the valley for me someday. Oh, there will be peace in the valley for me, oh Lord, I pray. There'll be no sadness, no sorrow,
oh my Lord, no trouble I see.
There will be peace in the valley.
Amen. Once you got that orchestra straightened out, man, you was able to go with it. Amen. You got your Bible? Let's turn again to the Gospel of John as we've looked at this last week of the life of Jesus and the Gospels, as we've seen Matthew, Mark, Luke, and today we have looked at John. And there's a passage here we've simply undertitled, Loving to Lose, when we think about that Jesus himself came to take away the sins of many. Take away the sins of all who would call upon the name of the Lord, who would believe the Lord Jesus Christ. Indeed, once that happens in your life, you can have peace in the midst of the storm, like he was singing, peace in the valley. As one theologian wrote, there could be no peace in the valley until there was blood on the mountain. and that blood of the Lord Jesus Christ shed on Mount Calvary, that we might have peace. As Jesus said, "My peace I give unto you, not as the world giveth. I give unto you a peace that shall never pass away." And we can know that when we know Him. John chapter 12, we're going to read down beginning in verse 20 through verse 26 instead of 25. Let's all stand as we read the word of the Lord together. John 12, beginning in verse 20. "And there came certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast. The same came therefore to Philip, which was at Bethsaida of Galilee, and desired of him, saying, Sir, we would see Jesus. And Philip cometh and telleth Andrew, and Andrew and Philip tell Jesus. And Jesus answered them, saying, The hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone, but if it die, it bringeth forth much fruit. He that loveth his life shall lose it, and he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto eternal life. If any man serve me, let him follow me, and where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor." Lord, bless your word. Open our hearts to receive its divine truth. We pray in Jesus' wonderful name. Amen and amen. Thank you. You may be seated. This morning we look to what has been called the triumphal entry of the Lord Jesus Christ, entering in to the city of Jerusalem when all of them were saying praise to the Lord, glory, hallelujah. The same bunch that a few days later would cry, "Crucify him." And then after the crowd had dispersed and Jesus was talking with some of his disciples, he began to give them a great lesson about their spiritual life and about our life if we're going to follow the Lord together. Now, many people will think that you're crazy if you say that you love to lose. I saw a young man this morning. I asked him about the game that he was playing. He said, "Well, we lost." And he told me who they lost to and all that. And I said, "Well, don't despair. You'll get another chance next year. You got a long way to go." But we talk about loving to lose. People say, "Oh, no, I don't love to lose. I love to win. I want to win, 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 win." Well, how many of you understand that you'll never win all the time? I don't care how far you go. At some point, there's going to be a loss that is affected in our life, and somewhere there's going to be a loss on our side of the column. But today, we have the idea that everybody must win. College football now is turned upside down because they decided to pay athletes when they were paying them all the time on how much more they could want. But a lot of coaches are resigning and getting out because there's no way that they can deal with that anymore. It's become a method of money and not a ministry to young men who are playing football. Same thing is happening in basketball, baseball, and other places. And we see the scandals as they come every day because people are caught up in the idea of winning. Winning, winning, winning. It's amazing when you pay a guy $750 million to play baseball, and then to find out that they're involved in the whole aspect of things that are going on. He has a guy with him who's supposed to be his interpreter manager, and he's stealing millions of dollars. Amazing when you have a professional football team and find out somebody who's representing them steals millions of dollars. It's all because we have this attitude that you always got to win. No matter what, you got to win, win at any cost. And what a lie that is, because Jesus tells us in the spiritual world, it is just the opposite. That if we're going to be victorious, we must lose. Jesus says this in a real way, that people can see Him in your life. Until you really lose yourself in Him, they will never see Jesus in your life. Until we lose ourselves in the person of the Lord Christ, it will always be something else. Until we lose ourselves in Him, it's going to be selfishness. It's going to be greed. It's going to be stealing. It's going to be dishonesty. It's going to be lies. Until we lose ourselves in the person of Jesus who is able to lift us up. And it's all based on one principle that you find at the end of verse 21, and you can underline it in your Bible. It simply says, "Sir, we would see Jesus." Sir, we would see Jesus. All of us need to have that etched in our brain and in our heart and in our life. We need to have it etched in our business dealings. We need to have it etched in our family dealings. We need to have it etched in our marriage dealings. We need to have it etched in our daily life. If we claim to know him, then people should see him, amen? And they should see him evident in our life and what we do, what we say, how we live, what's going on within our very being. So as this unfolds before us, we look in this passage of Scripture where Jesus teaches us about how to love to lose. But he does so by introducing to us an inquiry that takes place in the place of the word of the Lord. First of all, man's inquiry in verses 20 through 22. The Bible said there were certain Greeks among them that came up to worship at the feast. And this is very loose terminology. We don't know who they were going to worship or what they were going to worship. Perhaps they were Christians that had been reached with the gospel some way, somehow, but we have no evidence of that. But I think if you really dig down to the heart of it, they're trying to find this person that they hear is healing and raising the dead and creating miracles and turning water into wine and raising the sick up and bringing all these things to pass. They're trying to find this one they heard that fed 5,000 with just a little boy's lunch. They're trying to find this one that all these things have come about. And the Bible says that they came to Philip, which was a Bethsaida of Galilee, and they desired him, saying, "Sir, we would see Jesus." Maybe perhaps out of curiosity. I don't know. They were wanting what others have said, and they wanted to know about that. That's why you have these conflagrations, these little fires that build up in various places across this country. Something can happen. It happened down in the Brownsville area in the panhandle of Florida, in which they started this successive revival that was supposed to go on week after week after week until it became, and it finally had burned itself out. But people would flock there because they wanted to see this thing that was going on. And it became so ridiculous that there were people who claimed that they were in the spirit and they were laughing like hyenas and they were barking like dogs and all this thing. And they said all that was the work of the Holy Spirit of God. And people would drive thousands of miles to get there to see it. You have a little flame that develops up in Kentucky at a college campus, and there are people who are making professions of faith and this sort of thing. And people will go there because they want to see what's going on. They want to find out what is this phenomenon that's taking place. And you see, these Greeks were no different. They wanted to find the phenomenon of Jesus and what was happening with Jesus and what was taking place with Jesus Christ. So they have come to this place, worshiping even what or who they did not know. But the word worship there is not like we think of proclamation and prostrating ourselves before the Lord. So perhaps out of courtesy, I don't know, but the Bible says there in verse 21 that they came and they wanted to see Jesus. They knew someone who had found Jesus, and they know Jesus is the one they really need. And why sometimes, do you ever ask yourself the question, why do some people come to church? Why do some people come where songs are sung and the word is preached? And sometimes, you know, I get accused of preaching it too hard and too deep and too long. I thought we wouldn't get out tonight. We started in our 6 o'clock Bible study, 5 o'clock Bible study. We started talking about demons and angels, angels good and angels bad. And we're going through a thorough thing of that. But I said to all those who are in that room this afternoon, listen, this is really, really going to get deep, 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 deep. And if you're willing to go down in the Word, we can go there. But we will see as we go along. And Jesus was saying, if you're going to follow me, it's going to get deep, deep, and deeper. And you've got to decide what you're going to do and how far you want to go. I told you about a young man that broke my heart many years ago. We had a 6 o'clock morning Bible study, and we were going through a particular study there. And we came to that point of decision where you talk about committing your life to Jesus Christ and what you're willing to lose in order to gain him and what you're willing to gain in order to lose the things of the world. And he said to me simply this after the study that morning. He said, "Preacher, I want you to know something. I probably won't be back to this study." And I called him by name and I said, "Well, I'm sorry to hear that, because I really think it's something that'll be good for you and help you." And here was his reply: "I don't think that I really want to go that far with Jesus Christ. I don't think I really want to go that far with Jesus Christ. And you see, honestly, I have to say I commend him for his truthfulness. I pray for him for his error, but I commend him for his truthfulness. He just said what a lot of people who sit in church every Sunday don't ever say, because they really don't want to go that far with Jesus. They want to go to the well of blessing. They want Jesus to heal them. They want Jesus to help them financially. They want Jesus to solve the problem. They want Jesus to do this and Jesus to do that and Jesus to do the other. But when Jesus said, come and follow me, and it's going to cost you in your life, they said, no, I'm not going there. I want you to serve me and live. Oh, no, I'm not going to do that. I've got my own agenda. I've got my own way. I'm going to do things on my own terms. I really cannot follow Jesus that far. And you see, all of these disciples were being taught of Jesus in these days as he was going to the cross. They had to decide if they were really going to follow him that far, if they were really going to do the things that Christ would have them to do. It's a powerful statement that arises out of that church, out of that search for Jesus. Sir, we would see Jesus because it has in it the connotation of the security of salvation and the summary of a saved lifestyle. Because with me and with you, and many times I fail miserably, and I'm sure that you feel the same way, but really and truly, our goal should be wherever we go, whatever we do, that somehow people would see Jesus. There was an old song we used to sing, let others see Jesus in me. While passing through this world below, and others your life may view, be pure within and without, let others see Jesus in you. And so we would see Jesus. And you know, every day, really, I think that I ought to get up and you ought to get up every morning. The first thing we ought to pray is, Lord, let somebody today see Jesus in me. Let somebody today see you in your saving, consoling, comforting, helping power. Let somebody see Jesus in me this day. So these men's inquiry becomes quite a structure. You see, it was so meaningful that the great preacher Charles Haddon Spurgeon, when he had his pulpit built in the Metropolitan Tabernacle, he had etched in 3-inch deep letters into the wood the words, Sir, we would see Jesus. Whenever he got up to preach, it was etched in that pulpit in front of him, that people may see Jesus and the saving power of Jesus and the saving power of the work of the living God. So if you're going to see Jesus in your life, Jesus said there are certain things that must arise in us. First of all is man's instruction from God. Look at verses 23 and 24. And Jesus said to them, the hour is come that the Son of Man should be glorified. Glorification comes only through death. Glorification does not come in life. We aren't glorified living this life. We glorify the Lord by the way that we live. But our glorification will never come in this life. It will not take place in this world in which we live. It is not in the physical world, but it is in the spiritual world. You see, there are three steps that you take. Number one, first of all, you take salvation. That is free where you are free from the past of sin. Sin no longer engulfs your life because you're set free from the sins that have beset you and the things that have moved into your life. You have salvation because you are now saved to heaven and you're saved from hell. You have salvation because Jesus applied his blood and cleansed your life from all unrighteousness. You have salvation so you are free from that power and that past of sin that has engulfed you. After you get saved, after you have salvation, then you receive justification. Then you are free from the guilt of the past. You're free from the things that enslave you. And if you're going back and letting your past rack you with guilt today, then you need to go back to your salvation. And you need to say, Lord, if you save me, then Lord, you're also able to deliver me. Because you cannot go forward looking in the past I know a lot of people try it. I think they do. I watch them driving down the road, and I think they're looking behind them when they're trying to drive forward. Amen. And it's an amazing thing, but we can't go forward with God as long as we're looking back. We can't drive forward with God when we're always saying, well, I used to, we used to, this used to, that was, this, that, and the other. You can't keep looking back. You've got to look forward, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of your faith, who is so able to take you forward in the power and the person of Almighty God. You cannot rest on past laurels. You must rise up in the victory of things that the Lord has ahead in your heart and in your soul. You can't remind people of the things they did in the past, but help them to know that there's a forgiving Savior who will take them to the future in forgiveness. You must also tell them, because they claim to know Jesus, they cannot continue in sin, and they cannot continue to walk in the power of sin. For to do so is to play with the sin unto death, and the danger of losing your physical life, because you're cheating on God and you're cheating the things of God in the world in which you live. So glorification comes only through death. You have salvation, then you have justification, and one day you will have glorification. Glorification. You're free now from the presence of sin and glorification. You're free from the power of sin and justification. You're free from the past of sin and salvation. But you're free from the power of sin and justification, because you don't have to sin. Nothing makes you sin. We all sin and come short because we fail God, not because that it just happens in our life. Amen. So we have justification, whereby we're free from the power of sin to make us. But one day we're going to be free from the presence of sin. Yeah. Woo! Hallelujah. That'll make a Baptist shout. To know that one day we won't have to deal with the temptation, the trials, and the struggles, and the heartaches, and the pain, and the misery, and the lust of this world, and the pride of this life, and all these things that we think we've got to have, and that we want, and this has got to be this way, and this has got to be that way, and we'll be through with the vanity of this world that says this has got to happen, and that's got to happen. I've got to have all the accoutrements of this world. We'll be free from that, because we'll be free from the presence of sin. All those things come as a result of our sin nature, don't you understand? All those things come as a result of our sin nature that we must have, we got to have, this has got to be, that's got to be. And it all eludes us into falling into sin, separating from the presence of God. So he reminds us that in order to lose and to live in the power of Christ, he gives an illustration in verse 24. Death is a natural process of God for abundance. Look at it, verse 24, very well. Verily, verily, I say unto you, except a corn of wheat fall into the ground and die, it abideth alone, but if it die, it bring forth much fruit. You can take a kernel of corn, and you can have a whole pack of seed corn. And you can have that pack of seed corn, and you can put it up on the shelf. I've known people that have saved varieties of corn for years and years and years and years and years and years and years. And like Jesus said, what is it? It is simply idle when it abides alone. When it's just there, and you go by and you look at it, and you say, well, that's good corn. Grandpa had that corn. And that's good corn. That was Indian corn. Or you have this, whatever. Oh, that was great corn. It was good corn. It was marvelous corn. It was wonderful corn. All that that you there, you pass by every day. But you know what? It's absolutely of no value until you take that grain of corn and you put it in the dirt, like he says right here. It falls into the ground. And there it is. It begins to die. We know what happens. As that seed begins to swell from the moisture and the nutrients of the ground, and it begins to burst open, and it's not anything like you planted, and now it suddenly shoots up a sprout through the ground. And as that sprout continues to grow, one day you go out there, and it's got all kind of little funny-looking things on it, and the next thing you know, you look down there, and it's got an ear on it, an ear of corn. Remember, you planted one little grain of corn. And now it comes to maturity, and you take that and take the shuck off of it and look at it, and how many grains of corn are on there? You see, because it died, it brings forth, look at the end of that 24th verse, it brings forth much fruit. Jesus said, you and I are never going to bring forth much fruit until we die to ourselves and we live to Christ, until we're willing to lose in order to gain, until we're willing to let go in order to let God have his way in power and in truth and the miraculous. The principle is there. Bear yourself in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul said we must be crucified with Christ. He would say of the cross, for in that cross there is an offense. And Paul would write and say in Galatians, but God forbid that I should glory save in the cross, by whom the world is crucified unto me. That is, I've lost to the world. And I have been crucified unto Christ, and now I'm alive unto him. But until this world is put down here and Christ is put up here in our lives, we continue to lose until we die to ourselves and we live to Jesus and know the power and the promise of our Heavenly Father. What a glorious truth Jesus teaches his disciples, because he knows in just a few hours he's going to be hung naked on a cross. Nails are going to be in his hand, the crown on his head, all those thorns puncturing his brow, the blood running down, the sweat, the horror. He's thirsty, and they give him vinegar to drink. They laugh at him. They plucked out his beard. They slashed his back. And now when he's on that cross and he's taken every sin that you ever committed, that I ever committed, or ever shall commit, and all of a sudden, as it grows dark upon the face of the earth, as a symbol of the blackness and darkness of sin, and the sun seems to hide its face, and the earth is in a quiver of what is happening, and there's an earthquake that shakes the place, and we hear the voice of Jesus as we look in the book of Psalms on Wednesday night, where he cried out and said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me?
Amen.
And all of them wagged their head, and they walked by, and they said, well, he has lost it all. He's lost it all. We're through with him. He's lost it all. He's never going to accomplish anything he wanted to do. His little band of followers have scattered. Old John's over there, but John's not a threat to anybody. We're going to pretty soon bundle him up and take him and drop him off in the Isle of Patmos, and that'll be the end of him. We won't ever have to worry about him anymore. John lost himself on the Isle of Patmos. He gained the glory of God in the book of Revelation.
Amen.
All that we see. Jesus said, except you die to yourself. Until you die to your vanity. Until you die to all the things of the world that's got their tentacles wrapped around you. Until you die to the lust of flesh and the pride of life and the lust of the eye. Until you die to that, you'll never know what it is to gain the fullness of Jesus Christ in power and in truth. So the pattern is seen. The Bible tells us down there in verse 25 that here's the investigation of man's life and love, because he gives us the totality of it all. He that loveth his life shall lose it. And he that hateth his life in this world shall keep it unto life eternal. Now, what does that mean? When he says, he that loveth his life shall lose it, God said, if you really want to know what living is all about, lose your life in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. And you'll find what loving is all really happening in your soul. You see, you don't even know what love is until you lose yourself in the authority of the Lord Jesus Christ for him to love through you. You don't know what it is. It'll be something else besides the things of that you imagine and the things that you think, well, you know, I know I'm in love with this happening. I know I'm in love with that happening. You got all your little check-off marks that you have. God said, no. You don't even know what love is until you lose yourself in me. And if you lose yourself in me, then you're going to gain your life. And you're going to gain the power of the great things of Almighty God. Why, who would have ever heard about a fisherman named Peter? Who would have ever heard about a farmer named James? Who would have ever heard about a poor old fellow by the name of John on the Isle of Patmos. If they had not lost themselves in Jesus Christ, and you have eternally recorded in the Word of the living God what the Lord did in their heart and in their life. You see, loving and living only for this present world will bring you tragic loss. I often tell groups that I'm speaking to like this, and years ago when I would have to meet with different groups to talk about various things and motivation, this sort of thing, I said, you know, you can really climb high. You can set your sights to get over the wall to fame and fortune and the things of this world. And you can lean your ladder up against the wall and you can make your steps upward. And we can say, oh, he's climbing the ladder. He's successful. He's going to go somewhere. He's climbing the ladder. But the only sad thing about that is that many climb the ladder, and when they get to the top, they find that they've got it leaning against the wrong wall. And this really isn't where they want to be at all. And you know, the sad thing about that is that all those steps behind them have disappeared, and they become entrapped. And for most of them, there's no way down. So the answer is the way up in the person of the Lord Jesus Christ. When we reach up to him, he reaches down to us. And when we cannot help ourselves, he is the help for our soul. The songwriter was right. When I could not go to him, he came to me. Hallelujah. He came to me. The glorious and marvelous truth of it all, longing for and living for Jesus, ensures life eternal. Ensures life eternal in the presence of heaven. So, what do you really want in this world? You want all these things, the world that got their tentacles in you right now? You know, it's sad. And maybe, I don't mean to be a foreseer of doom, but it's sad to me to see so many people that are so engaged in the world that they don't even know how to live. And then we start with our kids by the time that they get old enough to know anything. I look at children. They don't even understand how to be children. They're in this program and that program, this organization, that organization. And their parents are just driving themselves crazy. They got to get them here and get them there and get them over yonder and run here and run there. You know, there's a whole lot of kids I know that'd rather just be handed a wooden stick and let them get out there and dig around in the dirt. Let them be creative. Let them set their sight on things through their own imagination instead of everything being planned for them and everything being orchestrated for them. Let them be led of their own abilities and attempts to live in. And you know what? The same thing is true with Christians. Why in the world do we think we've got to have this and that and the other when all we need is Jesus Christ to take us and to lead us and to lose ourselves in him? And let him become the Lord of lords and King of kings. Loving to lose your life in him is absolute victory. And Jesus said, here is how the victory looks. Verse 26. If any man serve me, let him follow me. There's the key. And Jesus says, for where I am, there shall also my servant be. If any man serve me, him will my Father honor. Now let me ask you, what more could you ask for than Jesus to be with you all the time? What more could you ask than to be serving him and to know that he is simply there with you? But on top of that, Jesus said, because I'm there with you, if you serve me, my Father will honor you. Let me tell you what, you can get certificates in this world, you can get all kind of citations in this world, you can get all kind of completion diplomas in this world, but until God honors you, you really don't know what honoring is all about. The frenzy of this world will keep you chasing yourself for more success. Restless spirit. As I tell folks, you live on Gotta Have Avenue and you move over to Needmore Street. And then you keep trying to find, and you keep looking, and you're searching. And this has got not good enough, and you've got to have that and the other. And yet you hold in your hands a Bible that says, learn to be content. For with contentment and godliness, there is great gain. Yeah. Amen.
Amen.
And let all therewith be content. Tonight, it is said that if we came in a congregation this size and we passed out a tablet, and we simply said to people, write down 7 things that you want more than anything else, that out of a congregation normally this size, and wrote down those 7 things. Now just be honest, 7 things that you want. Doesn't have to do with the church, doesn't have to do with anything else. That out of 98.99% of them, that the name of Jesus would not appear on a single line. Think about it. Has there been any time this week that you said, Jesus, I really want you as my companion and my friend. Jesus, I really want you to take authority in my life. Jesus, I really want to lose myself in you. Has that even happened in your life this week? Or you said, Lord, I want, I need, I must have. But let me tell you what, the Bible says when you have him. The old song was right, wasn't it? He's all I need. He's all I need. Jesus is all I need. Have you come and given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ? Which world are you really living for today? And you say, well, I failed. Well, you know an amazing thing? When we see failure, God sees potential. And we think not, God thinks yes. Because he's a God who cannot fail. Why not come to him tonight? The songwriter said, years I spent in vanity and pride. It keeps me from admitting there's something that needs to change in my life. Pride is the arrow of the devil, shot from the bow of indifference, that will sink into the heart of little concern to destroy a life forever. Years I spent in vanity, the things of this world, all this stuff that I was concerned about, from the physical attributes to the financial offering to everything. Years I spent in vanity and pride, caring not my Lord was crucified, knowing not it was for me he died at Calvary. Do we need to slip out and come to the altar tonight, come sit, kneel, stand, whatever we need to do, and just lose ourselves in him? You see, because the world has tricked people in saying, well, you know, if I had this, I'd be a better Christian. If we had this going on at my church, I'd be a better Christian. No. Don't fool yourself. Lose yourself in Jesus Christ. Father, speak to our hearts that we might understand. We can't stay in vanity and pride, but we must come to Calvary to know the wonderful difference in loving the Lord and losing ourselves in the presence of Jesus and cut out all the foolishness of things and self-aggrandizement and, Lord, begin to lose ourselves in you. Except we die to self, we can never live to Christ. And if we die to self and live to Christ, then your word just told us, oh, we'll see much fruit that comes forth. And we'll stand amazed in the presence of Jesus, the Nazarene. So God, as we sing this song of invitation, we which is a hymn we have sung so many times in a worship service. But tonight it's an invitation compelling us to make a decision as we think about this week, particularly as we look toward this coming Friday and we look to Calvary. And Lord, we see you hanging there for me. Touch my heart. Touch all of our hearts tonight. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand as we begin to sing. We invite you to come. Don't put it off. Hurry on to the altar. Kneel. Come sit on the front. Come stand. Come pray. Whatever God would have you to do. Lose yourself in Him, would you?
Here's my sin, vanity, and pride. Caring not my Lord was crucified. Knowing that it was for me He died. On Calvary, well, mercy there was great, and grace was free.
Yourself a favor, beginning tomorrow, and of course we sent out an email that you could tap into, Journey to the Cross. It comes from Moody Bible Institute, which is a great study. But if you hadn't tapped into that to read that devotional every day, take your Bible and look at this last week of the life of Jesus, and look at these days, and think about them day by day by day, and the things that He faced. And He faced it for you, and He faced it for me. And think about it. And as you get to Friday, there should be somewhat of a spirit of mourning in your heart, but also a spirit of joy when you think of so great a price Jesus paid that I might spend eternity with Him. Jesus. Jesus. Lift Him up. As we sing our benediction together, you join hands with those next to you, and we praise the Lord. He is Lord.
He is Lord.